Hi, I'm back with part 7, and I want to go back to John. I'll go to John 3:16, which is quite a famous thing that we all know. For God so loved the world that he gave his only one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but through him. So as it says, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. So God sent his only Son and sacrificed his only Son that through him we can be saved. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned. See, it says stands condemned. You are stand to be condemned because you are of the world. It is not God condemning you. God is a God of love. God hates sin. God hates the rebellious of sin. He hates sin, and through God's wrath, that's what is expecting to someone. We're all going to face God's wrath and God's judgment at the end days. And what he's saying, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God, one and only Son. In verses 19 of John 3, this is the verdict: light has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light because their deeds are evil. Everyone who is evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that this is a deed will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly what he has done has been done through God. So I'm going to go back to John's 15, as I was saying, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. Jesus Christ is the true vine. He is your vine that is connected to you. And Jesus says in there that you are already clean because of the word, and I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I'll remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. So we must remain in Jesus Christ. And going on back on to what we were talking about is here we've got, I tell you the truth, a man who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in but by some other way, is a thief and a robber. This is John 10:1, and as John 10:10 says, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that I may have life and have it to the full. Have it to the full abundance. And this is what I'm saying. Not the full scripture has been put in here. The truth. And the word of God and the truth should be put into the scripture. This is why it's important, church, and it's important, people out there, that you need to read the word of God. Because if you were just to read this, John 10:10, Jesus once said, I have come to you that you may have life and have it to the full. No, that's not what the full scripture says. It says, John 10:10 says, the thief comes only to steal, kill and destroy. I've come that they may have life and have it to the full. It's not reading the full truth of what the scripture is actually relating to. So if we go back to where I was before, just lost my scripture. What I might do is I might look at another scripture here. And in this one, John 14:6 says, Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know the Father as well. From now on, you know him, and you have seen him. Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. And if you really know me, you would know my Father as well as from now on, and you know... And you do know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that he will be enough for us. Jesus answered, Don't you know me, Philip, even though I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, Show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words say to you, Are you not just my own? Rather, it is saying, The Father is living in me, who is doing his work. If you have accepted Jesus Christ into your life, and Jesus Christ is in your life, and you're living that life, then Jesus Christ is in you. Now, I'm going to move on to an article that I wish to share. This man is called Paul Washer, and I want to... And I'm...
Take a look at American Christianity. It is based more upon a godless culture than it is upon the Word of God. And so many people are deceived, and so many youth are deceived, and so many adults are deceived into believing that because they prayed a prayer one time in their life, they're going to heaven. And then when they look around at others who profess to know Christ, and see those people also just as worldly as the world, and they compare themselves by themselves, nothing troubles their heart. They think, well, I'm the same as most in my youth group. I watch things I shouldn't watch on television and laugh about the very things that God hates. I wear clothing that is sensual. I talk like the world. I walk like the world. I love the music of the world. I love so much that's in the world. But bless God, I am a Christian. Why am I a Christian? I don't look any different than most of the other people in my church. Why am I a Christian? Because there was a time in my life when I prayed and asked Jesus Christ to come into my heart. I want you to know that the greatest heresy in the American evangelical and Protestant church is that if you pray and ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, he will definitely come in. You will not find that in any place in Scripture. You will not find that anywhere in Baptist history until about 50 years ago. What you need to know is that salvation is by faith and faith alone in Jesus Christ. And faith alone in Jesus Christ is preceded and followed by repentance. A turning away from sin, a hatred for the things that God hates and a love for the things that God loves, a growing in holiness and a desire not to be like Britney Spears, not to be like the world, and not to be like the great majority of American Christians, but to be like Jesus Christ. I don't know why you're clapping. I'm talking about you. I didn't come here to get amens. I didn't come here to be applauded. I'm talking about you. People so many times come up to me and they say, oh, I'd love to follow you into Romania. I'd love to follow you into the Ukraine. I'd love to preach where you preached and planted churches in Peru in the jungle. And I tell them, no, you wouldn't. They say, yes, I would. I say, no, you wouldn't. Why? Because you'd be excommunicated from the church down there. What we need to see, I'm not trying to be hard for the sake of being hard. Do you realize how much love it takes to stand before 5,000 people and tell them that American Christianity is almost totally wrong? Do you know what it's going to cost me to never be asked back again to something like this? To be unpopular? Do you know why you do it? You don't do it because you get paid well. You don't do it because men love you. You do it because you love men, and because more than that, you want to honor God. I want to tell you something. We're going to go into Scripture, and I want you to look at it as it really is. Stop comparing yourself with others who call themselves Christians, who compare themselves with others who call themselves Christians. Compare yourself to the Scripture. When someone, a young person, comes to a pastor or a youth minister and says, I'm not sure whether or not I'm saved, the youth minister will usually throw out a cliche. Well, was there ever a time in your life when you prayed and asked Jesus to come into your heart? Well, yes. Were you sincere? Well, I don't know, but I think so. Well, you need to tell Satan to stop bothering you. Did you write it in the back of your book, the back of the Bible, like the evangelist told you when you got saved, to write down the date so that anytime you doubted, you could point him to the Bible? What superstition has overcome our denomination? Do you know what the Bible tells Christians to do? examine yourself. Test yourself in light of Scripture to see if you are in the faith. Test yourself to see if you're Christian. Do you realize if I dismissed us right now and told everyone to go knock on every door in this city, you know what we would find out? 99% of the people, at least in this city, believe themselves to be believers. If you go back to your hometown and knock on every door, because I went back to my hometown after I got saved and knocked on every door, and you know what I found out? Everyone in my town is a Christian. 85% of them do not go to church, and those who do go to church are not concerned about holiness. They're not concerned about serving. They're not concerned about being separate from the world. They're not concerned about the gospel being preached among the nations. But bless God, they're saved. Why are they saved? Because some evangelist who should have spent less time preaching and more time studying his Bible told them they were saved. And he did it so that he could brag about how many people came forward in his next revival. I love you. And there are men here who love you. And I want to go into Scripture now. Now that I've shocked you into life, I want you to listen to me. Listen to the Word of God and begin to ask yourself some questions. First of all, enter through the narrow gate. For the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction, and there are many who enter through it. There is a narrow gate. And you know, historically, one of the reasons I'm a Southern Baptist is because the Southern Baptists have always been quick. When other denominations have failed to realize this, the Southern Baptists have always been quick to realize that there is one gate. There is one God. There is one mediator between God and man, and his name is Jesus Christ. It's not multiple choice. Not every road leads to Rome. As a denomination, we have always told people what Jesus told people. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. So I praise God for that, that the only way any human being on this earth will ever be saved is through Jesus Christ. That is all. Because you need to realize the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and you have no idea what that means. That we were born radically depraved and God-hating. That we would have never sought God, never come to God. We have rebelled against God, broken every law. It's not just an issue that you have sinned. The issue is you've never done anything but sin. The Bible says in the prophets that even our greatest works are like filthy rags. For God. And because of that, you know what we deserve? The wrath of God. The holy hatred of God. You say, now wait a minute. God doesn't hate anybody. God is love. No, my friend. You need to understand something. Jesus Christ taught, the prophets taught, the apostles taught this. That apart from the grace of God revealed in Jesus Christ our Lord, the only thing left for you is the wrath, the fierce anger of God. Because of your rebellion and your sin. When I speak in universities, they're always quick to point out, no, God cannot hate because God is love. And I tell you, God must hate because God is love. You see, I love children, therefore I hate abortion. If I love that which is holy, I must hate that which is unholy. God is a holy God. That's something that the Americans have forgotten. Many of the things that you love to do, God hates. Did you know that? Pray for revival. You're going to have a youth meeting. You want God to move. But before you go there, you watch programs on television that God absolutely despises. And then you wonder why the Holy Spirit hasn't fallen on a place and why you have to create false fire and false excitement. Because God's not in it. God is a holy God. And the only way you and I could ever be reconciled to a holy God is through the death of God's own Son. When he hung on that tree. Now listen to me. If you're saved here tonight, you're not saved because the Romans and Jews rejected Jesus. You're not saved because they put a crown of thorns on his head. You're not saved because they ran a spear through his side. And you're not saved even because they nailed him to a cross. Do you know why you're saved if you are saved? Because when Jesus Christ was hanging on that cross,